Pope John Paul II was an ecumenical and modernist heretic of the Vatican II religion, and he believed in the anathematized heresy of universalism. It recently came to my attention that the Orthodox Metropolitan Kallistos Ware is an advocate of universalism. This is disturbing because when Orthodox bishops are ordained, they vow that they will guard the faith. They are not supposed to be attacking the faith. There are three main views about salvation: universalism, inclusivism, and exclusivism. The apostolic faith and church is exclusivist, meaning they teach that there is no salvation outside belief in Christ and his church. Metropolitan Kallistos Ware is a heretical inclusivist and universalist. Inclusivism is the Vatican II view that sincere people and non-Christian religions can be saved. Universalism is the view that everyone will be saved. In AD 543, the Emperor Justinian issued an anathema on Origen. He said, quote, "If anyone says or thinks that the punishment of demons and of impious men is only temporary and will one day have an end, let him be anathema," end quote. Universalism and Origen were condemned at the Fifth Ecumenical Council of Constantinople in the year 553. I don't see how universalists avoid the anathema issued by St. Paul in Galatians 1 because they are preaching a gospel not held by the apostles. The neo-Orthodox heretic Karl Barth and the philosopher John Hick are contemporary universalists. Most liberal theologians and cults hold to some form of universalism. God's attributes do not operate in contradiction to each other. It is impossible for God to lie. Hebrews 6:18, also see Titus 1:2. So if God says hell is eternal, then it is, whether anyone likes it or not. I am now going to reference several biblical passages. If one is going to claim that I cannot or do not understand these passages, he will need to give an argument showing it. Assertions prove nothing. The Bible clearly teaches that there is an eternal hell and that human beings go there. See, for example, Matthew 25:41, 2 Thessalonians 1:7-9, Revelation 20, verses 11 to 15. In Matthew 25:41, Jesus said to those on his left side, quote, "Depart from me, you who are cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels," end quote. The Greek word used in this passage is aionios, and it means without end. When speaking about hell, Jesus said in Mark 9:43 that the fire never goes out. St. Paul teaches in 2 Thessalonians 1:9 that the lost will be punished with everlasting destruction. The Greek word aionios is also used here. In the story of the rich man and Lazarus, located in Luke 16:23-31, Abraham said about the dead that there is a great gulf fixed and that people cannot cross it. St. Paul recognized that in spite of his prayers, not all his kinsmen would be saved, Romans 11. And according to Romans 1:17, compare Romans 3:21-26, only those who believe are justified. This is the apostolic teaching. This is the apostolic faith. Proverbs 29:1 says, "He that being often reproved hardeneth his neck shall suddenly be destroyed, and that without remedy," end quote. Notice there's no remedy. Romans 9:14 says only the elect will be saved. 1 Corinthians 6:9 says that the wicked will not inherit the kingdom of God. 2 Corinthians 5:17 teaches that reconciliation is for those who are, quote, in Christ, end quote, not for all people. According to Matthew 7:13-14, all will not be saved. Hebrews 9 is clear that there is no second chance after death. The urgency of spreading the gospel in this life supports the teaching that there is no hope of salvation after death. See John 3:36 and John 5:24. One thing heretics do is base doctrine on vague or unclear biblical passages, and they ignore or twist the clear and explicit passages. St. Paul said in Romans 3:4, "Let God be true, but every man a liar." The Athanasian Creed says, "Whosoever will be saved, before all things it is necessary that he hold the Catholic faith, which faith, except everyone do keep whole and undefiled, without doubt he shall perish everlastingly," end quote. Patristic teaching. Justin Martyr said, "For among us the prince of the wicked spirits is called the serpent and Satan and the devil, as you can learn by looking into our writings, and that he would be sent into the fire with his host and the men who follow him, and would be punished for an endless duration, Christ foretold," end quote. St. Irenaeus said, "Moreover," he says, "the book of life was opened, and the dead were judged out of those things that were written in the books according to their works, and death and hell were sent into the lake of fire, the second death. Now this is what is called Gehenna, which the Lord styled eternal fire, and if anyone, it is said, was not found written in the Book of Life, he was sent into the lake of fire, end quote. Saint Cyprian, or Cyprian, depending on how you want to pronounce his name, he said, as God, as he is merciful, so he exacts obedience to his precepts, and indeed carefully exacts it. And as he invites to the banquet, so the man that hath not a wedding garment, he binds hands and feet, and casts them out beyond the assembly of the saints. He has prepared heaven, but he has also prepared hell. He has prepared places of refreshment, but he has also prepared eternal punishment. He has prepared the life that none can approach unto, but he has also prepared the vast and eternal gloom of perpetual night, end quote. Lactantius said, both therefore spoke with truth, but yet both incorrectly, for the ways themselves ought to have been referred to life, their ends to death. We therefore speak better and more truly who say that the two ways belong to heaven and hell, because immortality is promised to the righteous and everlasting punishment is threatened to the unrighteous, end quote. I also have a statement from Blessed Augustine, but it's kind of long, so I'm not going to quote it. I'll probably put a little bit more information below in the description box.